Miss Watson's nigger, Jim, had a hairball as big as your fist, which had been took out of the fourth stomach of an ox, and he used to do magic with it. He said there was a spirit inside of it, and it knowed everything. So I went to him that night and told him Pap was here again, for I found his tracks in the snow. What I wanted to know was what he was going to do, and was he going to stay? Jim got out his hairball and said something over it, and then he held it up and dropped it on the floor. It fell pretty solid, and only rolled about an inch. Jim tried it again, and then another time, and it acted just the same. Jim got down on his knees and put his ear against it and listened, but it weren't no use. He said it wouldn't talk. He said sometimes it wouldn't talk without money. I told him I had an old slick counterfeit quarter that weren't no good because the brass showed through the silver a little, and it wouldn't pass nohow, even if the brass didn't show, because it was so slick it felt greasy, and so that would tell on it every time. I reckoned I wouldn't say nothing about the dollar I got from the judge. I said it was pretty bad money, and maybe the hairball would take it, because maybe it wouldn't know the difference. Jim smelt it, and bit it, and rubbed it, and said he would manage so the hairball would think it was good. He said he would split open a raw Irish potato, and stick the quarter in between, and keep it there all night, and next morning you couldn't see no brass, and it wouldn't feel greasy no more, and so anybody in town would take it in a minute, let alone a hairball. Well, I knowed a potato would do that before, but I had forgot it. Jim put the quarter under the hairball, and got down and listened again. This time he said the hairball was all right. He said it would tell my whole fortune if I wanted it to. I says, go on. So the hairball talked to Jim, and Jim told it to me. He says, your father don't know yet what he's going to do. Sometimes he spec he'll go away, and then again he spec he'll stay. The best way is to rest easy and let the old man take his own way. They's two angels hovering round about him. One of them is white and shiny, and t'other one is black. The white one gets him to go right in a little while, then the black one sail in and bust it all up. A body can't tell yet which one going to fetch him at the last. But you is all right. You going to have considerable trouble in your life and considerable joy. Sometimes you're going to get hurt, and sometimes you're going to get sick, but every time you's going to get well again. There's two gals flying about you in your life. One of them's light, and t'other one is dark. One is rich, and t'other is poor. You's going to marry the poor one first, and the rich one by and by. You wants to keep away from the water as much as you can, and don't run no risk, case it's down the bills that you's going to get hung. When I lit my candle and went up to my room that night, there sat Pap, his own self.